So Dr. Benson is on her way down. You're going to meet her for this afternoon, I think we have. When is?
Yeah.
You'll hear from her tomorrow about future drugs in development. But why don't we go ahead and get started? I'll introduce the panel real quickly, starting at the far end, Dr. Steve Johnson, who's at University of Colorado Health Sciences Center. You've already met Dr. Clement. Dr. Ellen Eaton, you'll hear from today. She's a colleague of mine at UAB in Birmingham and focuses on substance use disorders. Dr. David Spach, who I think all of you know, is at University of Washington and does a lot of work in education, especially primary care, vaccines, all kinds of stuff. Dr. Hyman Scott from UCSF, he works at San Francisco General Hospital, and he's really engaged in PrEP, but also has a panel of patients that he continues to follow with established HIV infection at Ward 86. And entering the stage now is Dr. Connie Benson, University of California, San Diego, who has been involved in HIV research really since the 80s. And I'm Mike Saag from UAB. So we're going to spend about 60 minutes doing some cases from the clinic. And we have a little bit of time reserved at the end just for interchange. We could do it on question cards if you'd like. It might be just as easy to do it from the microphones. If you see something happening or we say something during the course of discussion, pop up to the microphone and we'll bring you in and hear what you have to say. Feel free to push back if we're saying stuff that sounds wrong, especially. These are my conflicts. So we're going to go over ART in patients who are starting therapy, switching therapy, and have HIV or ART-associated weight gain. We're going to look in the setting at virologic failure and high-grade resistance. And for this year, we're going to throw in some hepatitis B co-infection, C co-infection, HPV, and COVID, just to kind of spice it up and make it a little different than years before. So again, as I said when I introduced Dr. Anderson, the questions remain the same, but the answers kind of change. So here we go, what should I use as an initial regimen? This is a 48-year-old guy, newly diagnosed, he's asymptomatic, viral load is 280,000, CD4 count initially is 65. His labs are normal, of course, a lot of times with fast tracks, you don't have all these data, but let's say you do. Wild type virus, no prior medical history to speak of, normal renal functions, okay to start therapy. In this case, TXF could be TDF or TAF. XTC could be 3TC or FTC. And then I think you know most of the rest of the abbreviations. Let's go ahead and vote. Cue the music. Well, I think we're doing TV. We're doing TV theme songs. I lost my microphone. Okay. So this is like a Favarin's TDF FTC in 2007. You know, it's like the large green monolith. Let's not talk about BICTAF FTC. Let's talk about some of the other options here. So would anybody start dolutegravir 3TC up front, just without it being suppressed? I don't see any takers. If not, why not? Go ahead, Meredith.
I'd like to see hepatitis B status first.
Oh, hepatitis B is negative.
Oh, did it? I'm sorry.
I should have been specific. All other labs are negative. So he's hepatitis B immune because he's gotten his vaccines and he's a happy guy. Does that change your mind?
And you have a genotype that's wild.
Genotype is wild type. No M184V. So would that see the viral load? Let me go back here if I can. Yeah, viral load's 280,000.
Okay. CD4 other labs are normal.
I should have been a little bit more specific. Sorry.
So those are the main things I look out for. I think we're all gradually becoming more and more comfortable with these two drug regimens and using them sooner after the time of diagnosis. I think, you know, as providers, we like to sometimes just press the easy button, like a three-drug regimen is what we're comfortable with. You know, a lot of times we're starting before we have the genotype back or before we know someone's hepatitis B status. So TAF, FDC, BIC, even though you told us not to talk about it, I agree. I think that's what most of us would do. I would be very comfortable starting TAF or TDF, TXF, XTC plus dolutegravir as a three-drug regimen, just keeping in mind it's two pills, but very likely to be efficacious. But the 3TC DTG, I think if you know the labs are normal and the genotypes okay, then I think that's an okay option also.
I have a little, I probably shy away from the DTG 3TC just given the elevated viral load. And I mean, we have some data in people with higher viral loads like that, but I'd probably, with a viral load that high, probably be more comfortable with, option B there that everyone chose, but.
And you could de-escalate later if you wanted to?
Yeah, potentially.
Okay. Other thoughts, Dave, you have?
I mean, I think the way it usually practically plays out in the clinic is a person shows up, you have a new diagnosis, and we are jumping right in and getting people on antiretroviral therapy. So we usually don't have this luxury of having a genotype at the time we're making this initial decision. So practically, I think that's why this usually doesn't come up. The only other piece of information I want to know is just making sure he hadn't been on cabotegravir for PrEP, because that's the only thing that would change my opinion about A or B or, you know, the BICTAF FTC or dolutegravir TAF FTC is preferred if he had had cab PrEP.
Yeah. So, Hyman, you do a lot of work on both sides, the PrEP side and the treatment side. So let's say he had been on cabotegravir with cabotegravir as PrEP, and he broke through. Would that affect your thought here? How would you approach that?
Yeah, I'll talk about this a little bit tomorrow.
Previews.
So especially if he had on-time injections and then had an infection, that's really the place where, so for those who are doing the pretest, then to keep in mind, that's really where you get resistance. And so in those cases, we generally would favor a PI-based regimen,
right,
to ensure that you at least have two active agents in case there is some insti resistance that's developed.
And you'll talk about this some tomorrow, but of the people who do break through, how many, is it 100% that are resistant to the integrase?
It depends on how many injections they've had. So it did seem to track pretty well if someone received injections after acquisition, especially if they got two injections, they were pretty likely to have developed insti resistance, nearly 100%.
Dr. Eaton, you're going to talk to us about substance use disorders. Let's say that we spice this up a little bit and say that he's a pretty frequent user of methamphetamine. And does that affect your choice here at all? How are you gonna process that?
Yeah, and we're gonna hear from one of our other speakers about specifics of interactions with methamphetamines. From my patients who are using stimulants, I usually am going for the option B. I avoid two drug regimens unless I know them very well. I should say I have some patients who use stimulants regularly who have great adherence, are undetectable, and can do well with a two drug regimen, but I wait until I know them and have that established history. But in general, I'm going with option B in my clinic. I should say I would love to have more long-acting injectable options. We've had challenges in our clinics around payment, compensation, kind of devils in the detail. But in an ideal world, I would have a lot of my patients with stimulant use disorder on long-acting ART.
Right. So I think there's a bias among most of us that someone who has, quote, a substance use disorder is not a responsible person. That's not really right, is it?
That's right. In our opioid treatment clinic that is integrated within our 1917 clinic at UAB, as many as 60 to 70% of our patients have an undetectable viral load, and that does not mean they are abstinent. A lot of them are in various stages of recovery, so I think it's a great point to tailor your ART to the patient's specific health behaviors, substance use, but also ART adherence, and it's not a one-size-fits-all for our patients who use substances.
Yeah. Dr. Benson, the package insert for cabotegravir piperine says to get people undetectable first, if you can, and then if you're going to use it, switch over at that point. Assuming you have all this information up front, no resistance, no hepatitis B, is this someone you could still go sort of direct to inject before the viral load is suppressed?
Well, I thought I was going to get away without having to answer a question.
Well, I was just trying to get you involved.
This is my punishment for being late. So. Okay, so I think there are ample emerging data to suggest that the oral lead-in phase is not always necessary, and that direct-to-inject results in outcomes that are quite similar to the oral lead-in phase. The only thing that would give me pause here is what several of the other speakers said. There's a very high viral load here, and I might not want to do that direct to inject with somebody who has a viral load over 100,000 copies to start off.
So we could tweak the story and say the viral load at baseline is 15,000, even though the CD4 count's a little low, and the person says, I hate pills. I'm just not going to take them. That might be enough to push you towards maybe doing it.
I'm still more persuadable to one pill once a day, but I'd be comfortable with direct to inject cabotegravir rilpivirine, but I would want to have the genotype available first.
But we're not able to get access to Cabenuva without an undetectable viral load. So for a kind of insurance and Medicaid.
Yeah, that's a good point. Insurance coverage won't let you do that yet.
I mean, we're doing that at our clinic. If someone is like absolutely not going to take a pill, and we, most of our patients are publicly insured, so we really don't have trouble getting Cabenuva or cabotegravir rilpivirine. I wouldn't do it every 8 weeks, though. I would do it monthly initially.
Yeah,
and there is we are seeing some data that there's some more failures that are occurring in those individuals, but it is either like no antiretrovirals or injectable antiretrovirals, and that decision is a little bit easier to make in those cases.
So you do it every 4 weeks because you like to watch people limp?
Yeah.
Is that it?
Well, they only limp on one side because it's the rilpivirine that hurts the most.
Okay, just checking.
I'll just second that. We use the UCSF protocol in our clinic, so we keep people on monthly injections for the first 5 to 6 injections and then go to every 2 months just because the data showed the virologic failures generally happened early on. And so we feel like once we've got them on monthly for several months and they stay undetectable, we're more comfortable going to Q2 months at that time.
Good. So we got somebody at the microphone. Yay.
We had a patient with a substance use disorder who just for every reason related to her substance use disorder, she had never had an undetectable viral load and had just been viremic for 7 years. And it was because she just could not wrap her head around taking medicine. Even the oral lead-in, we give her the oral lead-in, she brings it back when she comes in for her first injection, and she's like, I don't know what these are. So, and she had never taken it. So we started her on the injectable. She had a viral load that was in the 200,000 to 300,000 range. And after 2 injections, she was undetectable. The only thing that we could support her with was we couldn't get her to take her medicine every day, but we did have case management support that could get her to our clinic every 2 months.
Yeah.
So once we did that, it was the first time since she found out she was HIV positive that she ended up as undetectable.
And what was her reaction when you told her viral load was undetectable?
She cried.
Yeah.
She cried. She said, I didn't know what else I could do.
Isn't that amazing?
So
that's really impressive.
Yeah. So we spoke with the medical scientist from the pharmaceutical company. And they were like, yeah, we could just do it as compassionate use. We'll see if it works. So we tried it, and it worked.
Mm-hmm. Ellen.
Yeah, I was just going to add, thank you for sharing that example. I think the older model of bringing people in, observing therapy, there are cases where that's still helpful, even in the contemporary era. We have a patient who has cognitive impairment, uncontrolled HIV, and uses stimulants and opioids. And the only way we've gotten her to be undetectable is by bringing her in weekly. It does take a lot of transportation support, intensive case management, but she just needs a lot of counseling and reminders and coaching. Again, I don't think she has great health literacy. She just needs a lot of support. So if your patient's amenable and your staff can support bringing people in, even for a period, maybe a month, just to get that practice ingrained, I think it's something we underutilize in our clinics. So thank you.
Please.
So I'm in Alameda County across the bay from you guys, and we're also doing some direct to inject in some of our patient populations that can't adhere to an oral regimen. And one thing we've noticed, even in patients who don't have pre-existing rilpivirine resistance, is we're seeing kind of this low-level viremia, like maybe 50 to 100 copies. And sometimes it goes to fully undetectable, sometimes it doesn't. And we kind of don't know what to do with those. Like, I check proviral DNA and don't necessarily see any concerning mutations. And so we're just following it. But I'm curious if you're seeing more low-level viremia in your patient populations and if that would concern you with cabrilpivirine.
Yeah, we have seen that as well, and I've seen it in some of our patients on oral therapy as well. And generally, if someone has a low-level viremia and it remains low-level, you know, there's no evidence that they're at high risk of failure. If they start to see an increase, then that would definitely be of concern. You know, some of the things that we think about is, like, is there some anatomical reason? Is there injection? Was it, you know, not fully IM? Was there a problem with the completion of the dosing? So making sure that all those things are working well. And then for our trans women in particular, you know, ensuring that there are no other implants or fillers or anything that might disrupt, you know, so the IM injection that you're trying to give, because it is on both sides.
So, oh yes, please.
Just a clarification request for Dr. Clement. I think you said Q-month injections, was that for people newly diagnosed you went direct to inject on, or is that people that are already undetectable?
Yeah, I was speaking for just the general population. So anyone with HIV who is starting on injectable cabrilpivirine, we in New Orleans follow the UCSF protocol starting with monthly. Even if they're virally suppressed and it's just a transition.
Okay,
does
thank
that
you.
Answer
your yes, question? It does, thank okay. you. And then I'm probably misinterpreted this, but I thought there was a blip kind of out of Croy with cabrilpivirine and weight, BMI, and that it was preferable to start the oral lead-in if they were above a certain BMI before you started injections. Did I just make that up somewhere?
Go ahead, Dave.
I just want to make sure you're not asking about the issue of the needle length related to BMI, because that's a practical issue.
Yeah.
And I think one practical issue that that a lot of people have really made evident to me is that a lot of clinics do not stock the 2-inch needles, and the kits typically come with an 1.5-inch needle. And so one of the things I think people have really advocated is making sure if you're going to be having people on cabrilpivirine or cab prep, that you actually do have these needles in advance and you're prepared for this. But I don't know if that's maybe what you're thinking about. I've not heard of that related
to... Okay. We've got 2-inch needles, and we do that.
Yeah, correct. The BMI is mostly an issue of the needle, but there is not an issue with failure of the regimen, assuming you've got the right needle at the beginning.
In no
I think there was some
welcome.
Data that...
I thought there was something about Q2 month. The people that failed Q2 month, there were few people, had higher BMIs. I mean, that's the takeaway that I took from Croy last year. For the Q2 month dosing for treatment, people with a higher BMI, when you looked at those people who failed, they had higher BMIs.
Yeah. But I do think when they further looked at the PK and the circumstances of the failures, at least in the clinical trials where they reported that finding, the Q8 week was related to body mass index and the length of the needles and where and how the injections were being given. So I don't think that there's long-term data suggesting that higher BMIs have a higher risk of failure per se, as long as you're paying attention to the needle length and how the injections are being given.
Okay.
And just a practical note on the needle length issue, because we've had this issue as well. And the 2-inch needles are generally thicker. They're a higher gauge than the 1.5-inch needles. And patients notice those differences.
Yeah.
So try to get the higher gauge needle.
It may be stop using it, and that's why they have a higher viral.
Yeah, there was no long-term data, and like I said, it was just something that I thought I had read like one paragraph about, so thanks.
So this is, go ahead.
Just while we're on the needle length question, so we found that 2-inch needles have been on back order for, you know, ever since we tried to get them about 8 months ago. We haven't been able to access them. And we found multiple studies looking at IM injections, and especially cisgender women needing longer needles in general. And we've had even folks that we would have assumed to be, they've got healthy BMIs. We would assume that this is getting right into the muscle, and then they get a CAT scan or something for an unrelated reason, and we see all this stuff sub-Q kind of above the muscles. So I think that there's a lot larger population out there that's not getting this IM, and it's not just folks with extremely high BMIs. I think it's something that would be worth looking at. It could be a very small study and get a lot of data there. But just while we're on that topic.
Good, thank you.
Yeah, I have a CAB rilpivirine and anxiety question. We have several patients who were newly suppressed on CAB rilpivirine for the first time, but then fell out of care or were consistently late for injections, which increased our clinic anxiety for starting it. Do you have a consistent approach to those patients or screening?
So what to do when people fall out of care and they're on cabotegravir? I was going to mention that while you guys formulated a response. You know, it's interesting to me, for me personally, the dynamic of what happens when I'm thinking of using an injectable that's every month or 2 months is very different than how I feel when I write a prescription. I write a prescription, it's emailed to the thing, and I don't think about it again until they come back. If I prescribe an injectable, I somehow feel differently. I feel responsible for them coming back and tracking and having people to track. And that's a whole different dynamic on the part of the providers. I see affirmative nodding throughout. So what do you do in this setting? Meredith, you've had some experience with this?
Not extensive experience. I have one patient who fell out of care for, I want to say 5 or 6 months, and came back. We checked a viral load, and he was still suppressed. So that made me feel better about the situation.
So you put him on an every 5 month regimen?
He would like that. He would very much appreciate that. I think this is where it's all hands on deck strategy. You know, we have our pharmacists, we keep the Excel spreadsheet, we know when they're due, we know phone numbers, we try whatever we can do to track folks down if they haven't come to their visits. But it does provoke a lot of anxiety.
So that's a lot of effort, right? You don't do that for everybody, do you? Right.
You because they have drug in their system that you have given, you know, I think it's just a different
I think these are the points. I don't know that there's a specific solution. Doesn't mean that everybody who falls out of care is going to come back with viral rebound and resistance, but it is a risk, and that's something that I think we all formulate. A lot of the people I've talked to have used a lot of injectable cabotegravir for treatment. Are screening their population very carefully before they prescribe. And I think that's probably good advice for now. And down the road, as we'll hear from Dr. Benson tomorrow, there are other options that don't require IM injections that could be used sub-Q. Yeah.
Yeah, before we leave the topic of fillers and implant, I come from Augusta, Georgia, where BBLs are on the rise. So any words of caution with those patients?
Go ahead.
Yeah. Does everyone know what a BBL is? Yeah.
Brazilian butt lifts.
Yeah. So.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. So BBL is a Brazilian butt lift. So generally with the IM injections for cabotegravir and rilpivirine, we do ventrogluteal. So they're sort of on the hips, but there's actually a Sculptra as well, which is injected for some people. And so generally what I do is I sort of do an evaluation and see if there's any place where I can actually do the injection. Anatomically, you can often feel the areas, and then in doing more imaging, so you can do ultrasound or even CT scan sometimes. If this is going to be like the main option for someone, then we will sometimes do the imaging so we can see if there's any possible possibility. There are some PK data for thigh injections. That data, you know, the acceptability of those data actually wasn't that great. People felt like they hurt more than the gluteal injections, but those are people who had previously received gluteal injections, so we don't know what it'd be like if someone started with thigh injections. But we're trying to work with Viv around giving some guidance around that as an option, particularly for people who've had BBLs or other gender-affirming procedures.
So I'm smiling because normally I prepare this thing and it goes for an hour, and we're already almost halfway through the hour, and we're having this group therapy session for how do we treat people. It's actually pretty fabulous. Go ahead.
Just a brief question. And initiating someone orally in cabotegravir and rilpivirine was the fact that if you had an adverse event to the medication, it wasn't in you for 2 months. I'm assuming that if we're taking the brazen step of going directly to therapy, that's actually a rather rare event. I don't do much of it, so I'm correct. Just asking.
Yeah, thanks. I think that's correct. I think the right way to do this, if you're going to spell it out on a test or something, is that you want to get them undetectable like the clinical trials did, and then you put them on the injectable. And this direct-to-inject, meaning bypassing any treatment just right from the scratch, is mostly talked about in the setting of exceptions, right? There's somebody who's got an exceptional issue that makes you, sort of forces your hand, but it's not the go-to first approach.
I was just going to say, I think, clarify, because direct to inject gets used in two ways here, and I think in the room we're using it two different ways now,
right.
Because direct to inject sort of historically was talked about first as skipping the oral lead-in, and I think there's a lot of us that would say that's
right.
Become much more
standard. Cabotegravir.
On cabotegravir.
Right.
With cabotegravir, and just for various reasons, if people have already self-identified that they're probably not a good candidate for oral therapy, making them go through an oral lead-in may not be the wisest thing to do. So I think what we were just talking about a little bit ago was direct to inject from a new diagnosis, and I think there's two different things. I just want to make sure we're all on the same page on that.
Right. Steve, you were going to make
And that was my point. We the uptake of the oral lead-in has been very low. The vast majority of our folks are going from an undetectable on another regimen right to injectable.
Good. Well, even though we had a poll that showed 90% for number B, for option B, obviously any of these options can be employed based on the circumstances. And we've almost heard all kinds of examples of why we might use them. And I look back at the history of what we've had to choose from, and I celebrate this because we actually have so many really good choices that you can really tailor what you do to the patient who's sitting in front of you and to have a conversation and find the best regimen for them. So now we're gonna go to Dr. Benson, and we're going back to the future with Doc Brown and Marty McFly. And this reminds you on the right-hand side what the case is, but let's say we now have available, in addition to cabotegravir, rilpivirine, we have islatravir with lidocapavir. It's okay if you don't know details about those drugs yet. You'll learn about them tomorrow. This morning we heard about BNABs that's what the BNABs are, the two different types. And then an implantable lenacapavir with islatravir once a year. Can you imagine that? Assume that works. What would you choose? Go ahead and vote. Hypothetical, not yet even developed, implantable device that I created somewhere in my imagination is in second place. I love this conference. Okay. Dr. Benson.
How about letting me answer that question tomorrow?
Okay. We can do that. We spent enough time on it.
No, I think we really have spent enough time on it. But there certainly will be interesting information about lenacapavir, because I think that's the next likeliest competitor for your direct-to-inject cabotegravir rilpivirine regimen. And I think there are some pluses and minuses to that approach. Islatravir, as well, is an interesting compound. To my knowledge, they're not currently being used together, either in an implantable or sub-Q dosing, although that's anticipated in potentially in clinical trials. With a follow-on compound to islatravir, yeah. Maybe not the implantable part, but the sub-Q.
Yeah, so the lenacapavir is currently available sub-Q. We'll talk about that a little bit later, because right. It is on the market or available.
Right.
The implantable, just to defend that, and we'll move on because we spent a lot of time on initial therapy already, but the concept of an implantable is similar to what we use with implantable birth control or some other things that it does take a procedure where you make a small incision, place it, but the advantages are that, let's say there's a toxicity. If you've given an injection, you can't take it back, but you can remove an implantable. And I think that may be the way to go. But coming back to our commentary about injectable cabotegravir, we're gonna be obliged to track in a similar way to what Meredith described. And it looks like this could be the future, but we'll see. All right, let's go to an elite controller. Hyman, you've got colleagues all over the place in San Francisco who follow these folks. But this is a guy who was diagnosed with HIV 7 years ago. His viral load has been persistently under 50 without any therapy. Do you confirm that with a DNA test from cellular compartment? So CD4 count is stable at 870. Labs are normal. You do a genotype from the DNA, and it's wild type. He's okay to start therapy. If you think he should, would you start therapy now? Okay. Okay. So, Dr. Scott, what is your opinion? You have all your Peter Hunt and Deeks and all these folks who've been following elite controllers for decades. What are you doing in San Francisco now?
We give everybody treatment.
Even the elite controllers?
Even elite controllers.
Tell me why.
Yeah. Well, you know, I think, so this person's been positive, diagnosed 7 years ago. And so, you know, there are some people who have elite control and then until they don't. And so we don't actually know all the times what might trigger if they do lose that control. So I think we just have erred on the side of caution and somewhat conservatism to offering therapy to all people who are living with HIV, including
right.
controllers, without necessarily clear evidence of the same benefit if they were not elite controllers. And it is somewhat of a shared decision-making process, so we do offer the option if individuals really don't want to start therapy. But it would change our sort of approach to managing their follow-up and viral load testing.
Good. Any opposing view, or either way?
I think about our sessions yesterday talking about inflammation and things like that, and maybe some of the benefits of putting people on antiretroviral therapy. I also liked what one speaker mentioned one time, is when you have a subset of people with HIV and you don't treat them, it's kind of sending a different message that the treatment is not available for all. I think the Air Force did a study that elite controllers had higher rates of certain non-opportunistic complications compared to people on antiretroviral therapy. So I don't think kind of watching the infection, even in people that are elite controllers, is as safe as putting them on therapy, especially given the safety of our current therapies.
Right.
Yeah.
Connie, do you know?
I was just going to say I live in the world of neuro-HIV at UCSD, one of the premier programs in the world. But I've been very impressed with their data on neurocognitive abnormalities even in people with elite control who have evidence of even low-level inflammation. And I've also been impressed with the cardiovascular disease outcomes associated with low-level T-cell activation and immune activation in elite controllers. So there's a body of emerging data to suggest that there are consequences, even though they're able to control their viral load in the way that this gentleman has. So that's really persuaded me to be more aggressive than not in starting people on antiretroviral therapy if they fit into this category of individuals. And I see Mike has outlined some of those data.
Yeah, so there's a couple reasons why I presented this. Number one is to show actually the data from San Francisco. This is years ago with Peter Hunt and the group there that showed that this is just a marker of inflammation, but untreated you get very high, as we all knew from yesterday's talk. But even on therapy, it's markedly reduced from untreated, but it's still higher than someone who is an HIV negative control. So that tells me that the immune system is working to keep the virus under control, even when the viral load is suppressed. And I would think that would be even more so in an elite controller. For them to get elite control, that means their immune system is active. And over time, that, as we heard yesterday from Jason, inflammation associated with immune system function trying to suppress the virus is going to take a toll over time. The second reason I brought it up is that what we're going to hear more and more from the cure side of the research community is, since they haven't yet had success in complete cure other than Timothy Brown and people who have had bone marrow transplants, despite decade or longer of really intense work, there's been a divergence of conversation to, well, maybe we don't have to eliminate HIV. We can just create an immune system setup where the virus is controlled without ART. And I kind of go, wait a minute, that's the elite controller, and why is that an advantage? And it doesn't resonate with me, and we'll see what you guys think, that we want to end up in a situation where we can vaccinate or do something to create an elite controller situation when nowadays we're treating elite controllers for all the reasons you said. So I don't think that's going to be a futuristic approach. What do you guys think?
I think that was an argument that might have resonated more when the drugs we use to treat weren't as good as the drugs we have to treat
now. Especially
in
terms of toxicity.
Yeah, especially related to toxicity, but even in terms of tolerability and long-term viral suppression rates. And so I think it's often the term given is functional cure, where you turn someone into an elite controller.
Mm-hmm.
But that doesn't eliminate all of the things we're starting to observe as people with elite control continue to live their lives and we monitor what's going on with them.
Yeah.
So it's the same answer for me. I would treat them. If,
yes, please.
So if you have a patient that's not necessarily completely sold on taking medication, but could be swayed. I'm thinking of several patients in my clinic, but I don't know if I can order a CD38 positive, HDLA-R, et cetera. I don't know if I can order that commercially available, but is there anything that you might look at that would potentially be related to this level of inflammation? I mean, I know there's more interleukins that I can order now thanks to COVID and some of the things there, but.
Sorry, they mostly are using CD38, but there's lots of markers like you saw Jason present that you can follow. I don't know.
Like checking IL-6 or something.
Yeah.
No, I wouldn't follow IL-6, but there are a whole host of sort of markers in the category of CD8 T cell function and immune activation that are in the realm of things you can order now. CD38 was the first of the ones described, but there are some more sensitive monocyte and mononuclear cell markers now that might be better markers of the level of immune activation. And the other thing I would probably do too is there are some fairly sensitive neurocognitive testing you can do in individuals. And sometimes if they're hesitant to start on therapy, Now, you could say I probably have neurocognitive dysfunction too, but I'm old enough for that to be normal. But but sometimes some of those, you know, softer things are useful tools to help persuade people when you really think they should be treated, but they're hesitant to go on to some kind of therapy.
Right. One thing that you can use clinically, if you're following an elite controller, is the CD4 CD8 ratio. If that ratio is low, especially if it's a low 0.5, then that means they're about to likely progress. So that's something else that you have readily available to you. Other comments?
I just wanted to mention.
Go ahead, Steve.
I just wanted to mention that the term elite controller sometimes is used loosely.
Yeah.
And some people come into the clinic and, you know, their viral load's 400 or something that and bill themselves as elite controllers and maybe at risk of complications and transmission and so on.
I was just going to underscore Hyman's point about not everybody continues to main elite control. And I actually anecdotally had a patient who had well controlled, and then I didn't see them for about 5 months, and they came with a viral load over 100,000 and a significant drop in CD4. And I was not expecting that at all. I thought they would sort of pop through, even if they did, and have a very low. I don't know if they got super infected with a different strain of HIV or what happened, but it left a anecdotal impression on me that just because something has happened in the past does not guarantee that they're going to remain a lead controller the rest of their life. And that is one argument. I think especially people want to make sure they're, you know, not, they feel good about not transmitting HIV, you know, with that low virus, they should not. But if they break through, that's different.
Good point.
And so, we've had a few anecdotes of folks with, that are quote undetectable, that have had some progressive CD4 decline, despite having very low or undetectable viral loads.
Okay. So this, I'm going to give a heads up that this is a little bit of a trick question. So, I don't do that often, but I did here. So this is a 48-year-old guy. It's basically the same guy we had before, wild-type virus. A little bit more detail now on what could have been his serologies, his hepatitis B surface antigen negative, surface antibody negative, core antibody positive. DNA was detectable, but less than 1,000. And 4 months ago, he could have started on Ural's choice, a BICTAF FTC or this one, and he had a nice response. The question is, should you change his regimen at this point to something like dual therapy with dolutegravir 3TC, cabotegravir, rilpivirine, or some other choice? Go ahead and vote. Okay. The majority said no, not going to debt. Change wouldn't be prudent. Not going to debt. Who on the panel wants to take this on and maybe support the audience with what I think is the correct answer? The answer lies in the core antibody, isolated core. So that is what's called, it's an emerging thought process from hepatologists into HIV, but the isolated core positive is sometimes called occult hepatitis B. And the concept is that even though the antigen is negative, it can fluctuate and become positive. So to release your coverage of hep B in this setting is not advised. That's the take-home point. There's not a whole lot more to it, but I wanted to make sure everybody was aware of that. But I think you were, because 86% here, but on the pretest, I think 90% got this right. So I don't have anything to teach. Okay, let's move on. Now, this is Dr. Bodimo. We may have you come to the microphone on this one. How should HIV-associated ARV weight gain be managed? Not that it happens, because we see it enough to know it does. Yeah, go on up to the microphone, Roger. This is a story, got started on treatment with BICTAF FTC, viral load response, wonderful CD4 count response. But over the course of the year, weight went from 145 to 171. Fasting glucose was 101, kind of pre-diabetic with a hemoglobin A1C of 5.9. So in addition to diet and exercise, which we always say and hardly ever find people doing, what are the other things you might do here? Go ahead, read them and vote. Know this. Okay. Most people would change to a non-TAF regimen, or maybe even non-INSTI, metformin. 15% would start semaglutide. I'm going to turn to Dr. Bedimo to walk us through this. What are you going to do, Roger?
He's been sending me to the blackboard ever since I trained with him. So, yes, I think that I do agree that there's no real intervention in terms of antiretroviral switch that has yet shown been shown to better the outcomes of this particular person when it comes to weight change. So I would vote for no intervention in terms of weight. There's only maybe one study that we know of that did not resulted in some meaningful changes in weight with antiretroviral switch.
So would it stabilize? I mean, maybe it wouldn't go up as much, or I know it's not going to reverse just switching, but.
Yeah. So unfortunately, this is an issue that has been dogging us in the HIV community for a while. Frustratingly, 5 or so years into this, we don't have many answers. But a few that we do have are that weight change, if it's going to occur, occurs in a significant minority of people. So it's not what you see. Averages don't really explain the likelihood of weight gain in a specific person. So it's a minority. And if it's going to occur, it usually occurs early, in the first 6 months, in the first year. And thereafter, either the curve flattens a little bit or plateaus. Why is that trajectory important? It makes sense when you're deciding to change. If somebody was in that upswing, change may be maybe relevant. When somebody was already 2 years in and had gained 30, 40 pounds, we don't have a lot of evidence that there would be significant change with territorial switch.
Right. Panel, your all's approach when you encounter this, because I know you do.
Personally, with an A1C of 5.9, I think, that's pre-diabetes rate, I'd be starting metformin or semaglutide.
Yeah.
It's kind of this, the question stays the same, but the answer changes. It's like, what can we get and when? And what is pharmacy telling me today about 340B pricing or availability and supply chain shortages for semaglutide? But we've had a fair amount of success getting it for our patients.
And you use it in this setting?
For weight gain and prediabetes.
Yep.
I'm not saying that's an evidence base, but we have great evidence that semaglutide helps with weight gain in non-HIV.
It's faith-based. I believe this is going to work. Holy roly.
Hi, I'm a clinical pharmacist, and so I'm up here to say that I think some other option is really good. We have a lot of members on our team to help people with weight loss. We got to talk about dietitians. We have behavioral health who can work with motivational interviewing. You have pharmacists and pharmacist clinicians, depending on what state I have a license for it. And I think that oftentimes we forget about that when we just throw and say, okay, diet and exercise, but what does that actually mean for a patient?
I've been trying that for 40 years.
We've started sending pharmacists home with our patient to monitor their diet.
I just think it's really important to talk about the team.
Your point's well taken.
We have to talk about the team because there, it's just too much for one person to do.
Right.
You could probably give a medication. If you were going to do semaglutide, you'd obviously want to start much lower dose because that is going to make them vomit immediately. But, you know, I think we need to really look at what are our resources, because it's going to continue, I feel like, with our people as they age. We're going to see weight gain more and more, and it's a big concern for people. And so if we're not relying on our team and using the resources, we're not going to take really good care of our patients, I don't think, in the way that's patient-centered anyway. So
Your point is well taken. Your point. Another option is to give them COVID, and that will help them lose weight acutely. It's one of the things we could do.
Mike, I was just going to, go ahead, Connie.
I was just going to ask Roger, are there clinical trials underway with semaglutide in HIV?
Yes, I think that we also data on semaglutide in non-diabetics, obese non-diabetics in the general population that made news last month because it was effective, I think to the tune of 20% or so decline in not just weight, but outcomes. When I want to look at weight, there is more than a cosmetic issue. Let's just see if the weight change is actually associated with cardiometabolic risk. And it makes a difference if, and in that study that was published last month in the general population, not just did they achieve weight decline, but also decline in composite endpoint of cardiometabolic risk. In HIV, the only trial that has been presented thus far was from Case Western, where they randomized people into semaglutide, people with HIV, into getting semaglutide or a placebo. And they found that that's indeed, they also did achieve a decline in weight. The little concerning thing in that study is that the weight was not just fat, was also lean mass. And that should be a cautionary tale until we get more data. Now, right. There is a lot more data in the works.
Right.
Yeah, that's what I was asking. And are you aware of studies like this patient who had rapid weight gain after starting antiretroviral therapy to the point they become pre-diabetic? And then are there any studies underway in people with HIV in that circumstance?
Yeah, I still hope that the ACTG trial in progress will address this. I just have some concerns because that study started to address this particular patient population. People gain 10% or more.
Right.
But due to the fact that it was difficult to enroll, it switched to enrolling also people who are just overweight. So now we don't know how to interpret the data when it finally comes through. I think, and I hope that it does get presented.
Answers the question.
Yeah, it's just the question of when can I get semaglutide is probably the most common question occurring in our clinic.
No, I think
right
the
now.
Most common question is how do you pronounce it? Is it semaglutide or semaglutide?
Yeah.
And I've been told semaglutide. It's like we had somebody in the Mountain Time Zone over there who drifted away. So we're going to come back to the Western Pacific Time Zone. Yes. Go ahead.
I was just going to say that the way the answer that many people selected about a non-TAF containing regimen, I think most of the studies, maybe not all, but most of the studies on TAF and weight gain are really switches off of TDF, which is a weight suppressing drug.
Mm-hmm.
So I think TAF gets a pretty unfair bad name around weight gain, at least from the data that I've seen.
I can argue that with you. On the other hand, when you initiate therapy with an integrase inhibitor in TAF, the weight goes up more than you'll see it go up with TDF, perhaps because of that reason, but you know that's the outcome at the end of the day.
Go ahead. Yeah, I'd like to also second that by saying that when you look at weight, I prefer to say weight change in people with HIV, there are three different vantage points. You can look at the weight change in somebody who's antiretroviral naive and starting a drug and seeing if the weight trajectory is increasing, then you have to look at the trajectory before and after that. But then people can say it's just because they regain weight because it countered the catabolic effect of HIV. So in these instances, that's how people have first noticed integrase and tariffs associated with weight. Then let's look at people who are already suppressed while they take either integrase inhibitors or TAF. That's when that confusion might come, because if the large majority of people who are taking TAF in the US switch from TDF, mm-hmm. and it's clear when you look at the third vantage point, which is people who are taking HIV out of the equation, just giving the drugs to people who do not have the disease, i.e. PrEP, then you look at IPREX and you see that indeed a TDF did probably delay the weight increase that would have occurred without it, because people who were on placebo in IPREX did gain more weight than those who were on TDF. Mm-hmm. The same could be said for efavirenz to some extent. So now a lot of the studies that looked at INSTIs or TAF and weight change, even in antiretroviral naive people, could not address the contribution of concomitant medications. So you always want to see, we never use a drug alone to treat HIV, it's double therapy. But a lot of the analysis for INSTIs and TAF did not account for the other drugs that were used with it.
So we were going to have a talk on weight gain at this conference, but we ended up nixing it for this. So here we are. Good, thank you. Roger, over in the corner.
Yeah, I just want to ask the underlying question. Do we have clarity on why we should care about this observation of weight gain? And have we seen with TAF or INSTIs that there's actual end organ changes compared to other regimens?
Yeah. Roger, what do you think?
Well, yeah, that's what I prefaced by saying earlier, that let's look at whether this is only a cosmetic or appearance issue. It would be a lot more relevant if there were bona fide cardiometabolic risk.
Yeah.
We all already know that people living with HIV, in people with HIV, weight gain has a lot more likelihood of leading to diabetes or other cardiometabolic risk than people without HIV. That's true.
Right.
And that's been known for a long time. But also now we see that some data has to be confirmed. One we presented yesterday and others with like dolutegravir that could, dolutegravir, bictegravir may have cardiometabolic risk that need to be confirmed, right, or verified. So does a TAF. So let's leave it at that.
Okay, last question here.
Yeah, not really a question, just a comment. I'm a family physician practicing in Seattle, and I do a lot of weight-inclusive care, and I just wanted to put out there that there are a lot of patients who start avoiding medical care once we start sort of lecturing them about weight, and I see a lot of them later on once they've been out of care, and they're seeking a provider who is not going to lecture them about weight. And so just being mindful that we didn't know anything about how this patient felt about their weight. We have a 1 A1C value, which we know can stay stable over time. So just really being mindful of how much anti-fat bias there is in medicine and thinking about the way it impacts our patients. So I just wanted to add that into the discussion. Thank you. Yeah.
Good, thank you. Okay, let's talk briefly about hepatitis C co-infection. I'm going to turn to Dr. Spach here. 35-year-old, HIV, diagnosed 4 months ago, started BICTAF FTC, well-tolerated, nice response. On initial evaluation, hepatitis C antibody was positive. The viral load was 4.7 million copies per mil, genotype 3A. Liver enzymes were normal. Has already been vaccinated for Hep B. Elastography showed F2, F3. He still drinks about 2 to 3 beers a week, but not excessive alcohol, no other meds. So what would you use to initiate therapy in this setting? And I know you don't have your drug interaction thing with you, so you just make your best guess. We're just gonna let, we're just gonna let the music play for the rest of the talk.
You're just gonna let that run out.
Yeah, exactly. Let it go. So most people have picked the glucapivir, pibrinstavir. So you got to remember that the asvirs are the NS5As and the previrs are protease inhibitors. But you probably know this as Mavyret. So. Mavyret is the name. Yeah, go ahead, David. Would you? Yeah, please.
So I think that's exactly what I would do. The main point here is that this is like the Nike, just do it. We've been sitting on hepatitis C and not treating people for so long. This is a chip shot. This is something we want every provider who's doing HIV care to feel comfortable doing. So it is not hard now. The key thing is that the AASLD, IDSA, no longer makes HIV exclusionary in any way. People with HIV can be part of that simplified treatment approach, and that new OI guidelines place people with HIV in the simplified treatment approach, which is very, very easy. And basically, all you need to do is make sure you get an assessment for cirrhosis. This person does not have cirrhosis. Clinically, you just need to make sure they don't have decompensated cirrhosis. So if they have no cirrhosis or compensated cirrhosis, you can use 8 weeks of GP or glucapivir, pimentasvir, Mavyret, and you're good to go. You can also use sofosbuvir or velpatasvir, but if they have cirrhosis and the insurance is requiring that you're going to use sofosbuvir or velpatasvir, then you've actually got to get a genotype. That's a little more complicated, a little longer discussion.
Right.
But this has gotten really simple. And the very last point, you're monitoring. It's one viral load before you start and one viral load 12 weeks after you're done. This has become really simple, and we really want to encourage everybody
it
to be trying to do
it. It could be 13 weeks after you're done. It's the same thing.
Yeah. And the cure rates with this are, 97% to 99%.
You're looking for proof of cure. That's kind of the take-home point. In the past at these conferences, we talked a lot about it. Then we had a hiatus for about 4 or 5 years. And I just wanted to bring it back because it has gotten so simple. And everyone in our clinics who has hep C should be cured, period. There's no good reason. And you go to the guidelines, they're very simple, straightforward. And the drug interactions that we were worried about historically pretty much aren't at play much anymore because of the medications we use are not typically interacting. So when do I check for anal dysplasia? Real quickly, we have a 35-year-old, 10 years ago infected, or diagnosed on a stable regimen, nice response, history of receptive anal intercourse, abdominal anal pap is positive. He's referred for high-resolution anoscopy and noted to have a high-grade squamous intraepithelial lesion, HSIL. What do you do at this point? Treat the lesion now, monitor for 6 months, and repeat HRA, or not sure? Go ahead and vote. Yaman. Okay. All right, this was just to assure that everyone had seen the anchor study, and that's what you do. The biggest problem that I'm hearing from clinicians is that, yeah, I can do an anal pap, but I don't have anybody to do high-resolution anoscopy. That was your point?
My question is more to HRSA HAB. If there's ever going to be grants from HRSA HAB to get high-resolution anoscopy.
Yeah.
In our regions, because it takes somebody getting training, putting themselves out there, and
right.
Usually they're marginalized populations, and there's a lot of colorectal surgeons that only want to do this in the OR, if they're able to do it at all, and we need infrastructure development.
Dr. Cheever said she's going to fund everyone for training for high resolution.
Love it.
I'm kidding. I just wanted to get her to the microphone.
Yeah, so I think we feel like an imperative about the fact that people are going to have anal cancer, maybe die of anal cancer, because people cannot get that second step. So we certainly feel a lot of pressure around that. We actually have a law that like tells us how we can distribute money, and we can't distribute money in those ways. The one avenue I think we have is the AIDS education and training centers. And actually, I think David Spach might be doing a study right now to sort of figure out what is and how can that help us, how can we most effectively do that, given all of the different competing components right now. So part of what he's doing and all of the work he's doing for us is a study to look at that a little bit for us to better understand, based on the expertise that exists in the United States, how we could actually bring that into to the Rhinewood programs better, and then we can have part A's, B's, C's, you know, potentially fund people to do that kind of work.
And can I just say, I want to thank you for saying that, because the people that I am not an expert on HRA, but the people that I know that I work with that are, have told me exactly what you said, which is the surgeons, the GI folks are out, that they are not going to be the people doing this. So I would just ask for a show of hands, if there was a training mechanism, how many people that are primary care clinicians would be interested in learning how to do HRA? Okay, so that's a lot of people. So that's one answer that I think is important to know, that there's a body of people out there that are interested in learning.
Yeah. Now, Steve.
Yeah, we were one of the study sites for Anchor, and one of my colleagues, Hillary Dunleavy, was really involved. And I know there's been discussions with the U.S. Preventive Service Task Force and so on, so this is more of a question of when we're actually going to see kind of guidelines within the OI guidelines, or which could help actually kind of lead to resources.
Yes, the OI guide. We just had a conversation about what to do public relations wise and who should manage the public relations. The guidelines are due to come out very shortly from the OI guidelines panel. So
we've got about 10 minutes left. I've got a number of questions. I'm just going to go quickly because it's mostly follow up of what we said. So what about treatment of HCV with direct-acting agents during pregnancy? Don't do it. Okay. Wait till afterwards and then you treat. Hepatitis B surface antibody negative, but antigen negative, but antibody positive, that you still treat as if they're hepatitis B infected, and the antigen can wax and wane. So we've known or we've recommended that. In other words, not using cabotegravir in that setting necessarily, because you can wax and wane back up with antigenemia is a rule. Yeah. Okay. You mentioned an Excel spreadsheet of how Dr. Clement, is that exportable? Can other people use it? Is there anything available?
I just want to speak to the value of our pharmacists who help track these patients and keep kind of a record of when they last came in, when they're due to come back and help us follow these patients very closely. There's an app for that.
Okay. Recommendations for cabotegravir for patient virally suppressed, but initial genotyping results are unavailable. So somebody gets referred to you, they've got suppressed virus, you don't have pre-treatment evidence of resistance. Do you assume resistance and treat and monitor? What would you do? Go ahead, Hyman.
This is for treatment, right, with cabotegravir and rilpivirine. So what we generally do is we try to take as extensive of antiretroviral history as possible. So we pull up the photos, try to walk people through and see. I mean, the main concern is if they've been on an NRTI and had virologic failure as a result of that. So there is going to be some element of faith in this, Mike. But, you know, I think it's not a reason we don't offer this option for people, but we do take it, I think, with a little more cautious approach, just to be sure that we do capture a virologic failure if it were to occur. So that's someone who we would probably have on monthly injections initially, making sure that they're stable. But we try to take a history as much as possible.
Okay.
This is not necessarily evidence-based, but in people where we've had prior treatment history, including NNRTI, we have used archived genotyping as a tool. And, you know, there's a lot of issues with that, but you know, we've occasionally had circumstances where an NNRTI mutation has been found, and that's prevented.
What if you don't find it?
What's that?
If you don't find it, it's negative.
Well, the issue with archive genotyping is the sensitivity is an issue.
Yeah.
But you know, if we don't find it, I mean, then it wouldn't be a contraindication in my mind to use the injectable.
Let's say you have an elite controller who becomes pregnant. Do you treat him? I think, yeah, okay. In other words, I don't think there's a reason. In fact, you might have more reason to treat in that setting than an elite controller who's not pregnant. And then, okay, I've got to go to, let's go to this last case real quick. Well, all right.
Mike, you have a question.
Oh, sorry, question over there.
I'm sorry to do this. I'm going to bring us back to Hep B again, which is always a quagmire. I'm curious, we have a very high proportion of people with isolated core antibodies in our population, and we're not routinely doing HBV DNA in them. And I guess I would hesitate to say, should that be part of a standard at this point, whether both in our Hep C mono-infected and our HIV Hep C co-infected population? We see this all the time. Yeah. We do not see any Hep B reactivation. We don't see any sort of Hep B surface antigen flipping. Yeah. I'm just curious, sort of, are you recommending sort of a practice change in this, or are other people doing it and I'm not?
My understanding is that the hepatitis B DNA doesn't change the recommendations. In other words, the presence of an isolated core should be thought of, at least according to the hepatologist I've been hearing from, as not chronic active hepatitis, but generally the thought that it can reactivate, that the person's been infected, they might have, will have closed circular DNA that could become active at any point, so they treat them as if they are antigen positive in essence.
I guess I've heard them discuss that in terms of the use of very powerfully immune suppressive medications, bone marrow transplant, things like that. But for any person with HIV who has an isolated core antibody, are you doing HBV DNA in those folks?
I'm not.
I'm not either.
Yeah, okay. But I'm treating them as if they are antigen positive. In other words, I'm going to keep them on tenofovir or something like that as a rule.
Interesting. Okay.
At least based on what the hepatologist has been telling me, yeah.
Hello. Just would like to know if any of the panelists have experience with using Cabenuva in their elite controllers and their thoughts on it.
I didn't hear the question. Say it again. I'm sorry.
Your thoughts on using Cabenuva in elite controllers and if anyone on the panel has a personal experience with it.
Yeah. using injectable cabotegravir in elite controllers.
I mean, I don't see a reason not to. I haven't personally started an elite controller, but I would offer them the same options I'd offer anyone else.
Yeah.
The question I get more often is, can you use a two-drug regimen in an elite controller?
Yeah.
I mean, two-drug oral, I should say.
Sure.
Yeah.
Why not? Unless there's resistance, but you don't know that, right? Okay. So I've got this last case of high-level resistance. I think we can just have a brief conversation. This person has meth use intermittently, transfers to another clinic, is virally suppressed, prior exposure to all kinds of things, CD4 count and viral load back a year ago was susceptible, and now they show up, get hospitalized with viral load of 1 million copies. They switch to darunavir, COBE, 3TC, dolutegravir twice daily. Had some response, as you can see there, was able to get a pretty nasty-looking genotype and phenotype. Doravirine seems to be sensitive. The integrase inhibitors are kind of out, but you're on twice a daily dolutegravir. Are there other drugs that you can use here? Let's go ahead and... Which is the drug in this setting you most prefer, rather than coming up with a regimen? What's going to be your anchor? What are you going to try to for sure get in this next regimen? Go ahead and vote. That would have been my choice. Connie, what do you think? What's going to be your anchor drug here in that setting?
Same as your highly intelligent audience.
Yep. Okay. Fostemsavir is not a bad choice. Darunavir, no. Yeah. I mean, that's kind of almost the order, sort of, that right. I would think of. That's
it's
good.
Almost the order in which I would use the drugs.
Yeah. And then 9B is your second most. I think we've sort of already, well, go ahead and vote. Why not? Just listen to another song. All right, I rest my case. I think you guys did great. That's fantastic. Okay, that's kind of the way I think we should think about things. In the past, I would present a case like that and have all these complex regimens, and it was a mess. But if you just think about what's the most active drug and the second most, you got it. And I'll skip all these data slides. But the bottom line, and Connie will show that. But I think what's important is this slide, and I'll finish with this. This is a study from Scenix, Heidi Crane at UW, where they looked at the 30,000 patients within Scenix for whom genotypes were available as virologic failure happened, and asked the question of who are those with limited treatment options. That means you have less than two drugs that you can start. And as you would predict, 8% or so of people back in the early 2000s, that's what we saw, and that's why it dominated conferences. But look at the rate now. It's less than 1%. And what I thought was fascinating is that even among those in the current era who had limited treatment options and you didn't have much to offer, the virologic response was no different than people who didn't have limited treatment options. And that coincides in 2008, 2010 with the availability of integrase inhibitors. And that's been the game changer that in a lot of ways took these limited treatment option individuals and made them able to be successfully treated. So on that positive note, I will thank our panel. Thank you guys. I think this worked well with you coming to the microphone. And we'll wrap up.